Yeah, that's my, this is my teacher, yeah. Okay, yeah, so I'm Bronte. I'm from the University of Western Australia, based at the Albany campus. I'm a researcher there on Menang country. And I work with Laura on the Turning Ghana's Interconservationist Project. So while Laura gave a great presentation about how engaging with nature can benefit people, I'm telling you about the flip side of our project, which is what people can do for biodiversity within their garden, and in particular, how citizen scientists can contribute to wildlife conservation, and also urban ecological knowledge, which is notoriously difficult to obtain in these residential areas where accessibility is quite challenging for traditional science methods. And so before I go any further, I too would like to acknowledge that we're gathered on Kapi Kapi land today, as we pay my respect to elders past, present and emerging across Australia, and also acknowledge that back home in the southwest of Western Australia, the Noongar people have managed that land for thousands of years. So to reiterate what Laura mentioned, just in case anyone missed it, if they were out of the room, the Turning Ghana's Interconservationist Project is a collaboration between Perth NRM and UWA Albany. And it's funded under the Inspiring Australia Science Engagement, Australian Government's Inspiring Australia Science Engagement Program. And so the ecological part of this project has three key pillars, if you like. So the first is to research in collaboration with citizen scientists, the vertebrate diversity that are used in gardens, and also the benefits of wildlife-friendly structures for the animals that are there. If anyone's not familiar with the wildlife-friendly gardening term, it essentially means deliberately modifying your garden with the purpose of providing habitat for wildlife. And then the second key area was to directly contribute to biodiversity conservation through the provision of water and shelter sites. And then lastly, a key component was to develop skills and provide opportunities for residents to get involved in backyard conservation, which arguably I feel is one of the most important parts of this project. So our project took place in southwestern Australia across six different regions. As Laura mentioned, we had over 200 residents actively engaged from about 27 towns and cities in Noongar country. Each resident is indicated by that blue dot there on that map. So citizen scientists could engage in the project in two key ways. One way was to monitor the wildlife that occurred within their garden, and the second way was to install wildlife-friendly structures, particularly water and shelter sites within their garden. So we worked across vertebrate taxa, that was our focus, and they monitored mammals, reptiles, birds and frogs. And in terms of the structures, they could install bat boxes, two different types of bird boxes, possum boxes, reptile shelters, frog hotels, and for the water sources, bird baths or ponds. And once they had installed these new structures, they could then go on to monitor those new structures as well to see what was there. And with that wildlife monitoring, not only could they monitor the wildlife that was generally occurring within their garden, they could monitor their existing wildlife-friendly structures if they already had them before the project began. So just to give you a little bit more info about the types of monitoring methods, we wanted to go a little bit further than just presence or absence. We wanted to know also about abundances and visitation rates to gardens. So we had we developed some standardized methods that all residents were trained in and undertook within their garden, and they could choose any of these and as many of them as they liked, depending on what kind of taxa they were interested in, what wildlife-friendly structures they already had in their garden. So we had two key types, a general garden monitoring method, which was essentially just looking to see what wildlife are generally using gardens. They usually, as Laura mentioned, included an active patch search of the garden, camera trapping, or sit, have a cup of tea and count with a timed survey the amount of birds, for example, they saw within their garden. And the other key sort of type was wildlife-friendly structure monitoring. And that was where they either inspected in, on or under the structures to record what was using them, or they sat for the water sources for a 20-minute period and recorded everything they saw visiting the water. So this was done on a week, well, we encouraged citizen scientists to undertake these on a weekly basis. And it's been going on since August 2022, and they're still monitoring. So huge huge, sustained, prolonged effort by citizen scientists, and they've honestly been amazing to work with in this project. So before the citizen scientists went out and started monitoring, we invested a lot of time and energy into citizen scientist training. In fact, the whole first year of the project was dedicated purely just to engaging and training. So we did this in a few key ways. We developed a series of guides, so a species identification guide, a wildlife monitoring manual, and a garden structure installation guide. We then held a series of workshops across Albany and Perth in particular to introduce residents to these manuals, field any questions, and in general have those face-to-face chats and discussions, those relationship connections. And again, there's my dress, so it is true. And then we also had developed a video series which was similar information to what was in the in-person workshops, but we really wanted to provide that training to any remote resident or any resident that was unable to travel for whatever reason. And then Laura and I were points of contact throughout the project, and people could call us, email us at any point to ask advice, questions, send us cool photos, which was I loved. And just to show you a little bit more about these guides, they were designed to be really user-friendly, simple, engaging. The species ID guide was essentially a catalogue of images with some helpful little symbols to let people know whether they might see them above ground, below ground, in water, are they flying, would you see them at the day or the night. Our wildlife monitoring manual provided some simple step-by-step instructions to carry out the monitoring survey, including how you would record them, particularly if you weren't sure what species it was, some helpful diagrams to aid their understanding, and some tips and tricks, including pointing them towards some really great existing citizen scientist resources, such as the Aussie Bird Count app and the Frog ID. And then our garden structure installation manual gave where you could find the recommended design, how much it would cost, where you could, how you would position it within your garden, and why that particular design we had recommended as the safest and best for wildlife, to really upskill in what is considered a good wildlife-friendly structure and what might not be as good, even though there's really good intentions. So what they've achieved is fantastic, crazy. So over 12 months of wildlife monitoring, over 220 residents involved, over 190 different wildlife-friendly structures installed, and over 11,000 wildlife surveys. So massive amount of data, like so much. So of those surveys, 6,800 were general garden surveys, and a further 4,300 were surveys of the structures. And so that the information that those surveys tell us is really valuable. So they detected 185 different species within gardens, 132 birds, 10 frogs, 35 reptiles, and 8 mammals. And this information tells us what are some really common species we see in gardens. So for example, the New Holland honeyeater was the most frequently seen bird, the motorbike frog was the most commonly seen frog, and so on. But they also provided multiple records of threatened species within gardens, as well as exotics, which are also important to know about. So in southwestern Australia, they recorded that the critically endangered western ringtail possum is hanging out in a lot of gardens, and the threatened red-tailed black cockatoo, Carnoubi's cockatoo, and Borden's cockatoo are making use of gardens. And this really highlights that value of garden landscapes for wildlife. If we've got threatened species using them, there's heaps of opportunity to conserve, and in fact, we should. If there's so few species, so few individuals left, and some of them occur in gardens, what can we do? Perhaps even more excitingly, when we're thinking about what's using the existing wildlife-friendly structures in gardens, this is next and new knowledge for these particular structures. We don't really know in southwestern Australia what has been using them. So again, they detected 78 species using these structures, and also provided really useful information about which structure types are more regularly used than others. So water sources, the blue bars there, tended to be much more frequently used than the shelter sites, which are in green. So for example, bird baths, animals were seen using bird baths on 53% of all survey occasions, whereas something like a bat box was only used on 1% of survey occasions. It also provides really valuable information about the suite of species or suite of taxa groups that are using them. So ponds supported all four vertebrate groups, whereas something like our possum box was only seen, only possums were seen using our possum boxes. So this is really giving us insights into if we want to support biodiversity generally, maybe water sources are a good choice. If we want to have targeted species conservation, maybe some of these shelter sites are better. And just to drill down a little bit further, it also provides us this information about which structures provide species specific benefits and which structures can we employ for a whole bunch of different species. So if you take our bird baths, they were seen, 57 different species were seen using them, and the most common animal was the New Holland honeyeater, which accounted for 37% of records. Whereas in contrast, something like a frog hotel was only used by three species and dominated largely by the motorbike frog. And our possum box, which was only used by two possum species, western ringtail possums dominated that, and that's a critically endangered species. So, you know, this is really important because it's telling us, well, if we want to support a variety of wildlife, maybe a bird bath, if we wanted to do targeted species conservation for the western ringtail possum, a possum box is probably going to be pretty useful because it's not supporting a whole bunch of other possum species. And then lastly, they've also provided such valuable information about animal reproduction in gardens. So again, this is a really big gap in our knowledge base. It's great that animals are there, but if they're not reproducing and breeding, are they going to be able to be sustained within those areas? So citizen scientists in our project detected chicks or eggs in 16% of bird box inspections and tadpoles on 22% of pond surveys, suggesting that reproduction is occurring within gardens. And this little four set of photos is perhaps my favourite little collection. So it's one of our citizen scientists, Sally Malone. She captured a red-capped parrot prospecting the box. It laid six eggs, all six eggs hatched, and all six fledged the box. And I've actually just got an email a couple of weeks ago to say this year they had five eggs in the same box and all five chicks fledged on exactly the same day as last year, interestingly, which she had recorded down. So also really exciting and interesting observations. So getting really connected to nature, which is awesome. And you would have heard more about that from Laura's talk. Yeah, so what's my message here? So hopefully it's a really great example that it's a collaboration with three-way benefits. Citizen scientists have contributed really robust scientific knowledge about both the huge diversity of wildlife that occurs within gardens, but also how wildlife-friendly structures may benefit these species. So this has really highlighted and informed the need for biodiversity conservation within urban landscapes. They've contributed directly to conservation through the installation of over 190 water and shelter sites. And it's been a great collaboration that's empowered and upskilled community members to take action in their garden. So a project I've personally been like really excited and proud to be involved in, working with the citizen scientists has been like really, they're just amazing, like what they've achieved. And so hopefully a great example of how a citizen science project can not only benefit biodiversity, but as Laura's presentation highlighted, can also benefit people, which is a really nice two-way, you know, share. Yeah, and so thank you very much. Huge thanks to our project partners, the citizen scientists. And like Laura said, we're looking for opportunities to expand both geographically and in time this project. And so if anyone has any ideas, thoughts, or just wants to chat, get in contact with Laura or I. We're here for the rest of the day. Thank you so much.
Oh. Thank you, Bronte. We've got a little bit of time for questions. If anyone needs to roll on, feel free. But wow, the questions are coming thick and fast, Bronte. Back up to the mic, please.
Yeah. Hi, Bronte. Sorry. Yeah, I'm just wondering, I've seen the frog motels before, and you were saying that you gave advice about the best ones. In some videos, I've seen them being like a snake feeding station.
Yes.
what's the best, is it, do they need to be taller, or can you tell us a bit about the construction of them to kind of avoid that?
Yeah, it's more about, I guess, the variety of pipes that you use. So having small and larger ones to accommodate different frogs, but also to avoid the snakes. And we elevated them, so we didn't have them right like on the ground. They're not going to be useful for non-tree frogs, but elevating helps with those snakes. But it's actually one of the reasons that we wanted to undertake this project, is that knowledge like that of snakes, using them, is really important so that we can then improve designs. And so that was one of the things we wanted to do, is get our residents to tell us, like, did you see a snake using it? You know, did you see foxes or cats using your bird bath or surrounded your bird bath? They're the sorts of information that we wanted to inform in the future best practice wildlife-friendly gardening.
Thank you for that. Funny enough, I was about to ask that question about cats.
Yes.
If you've got data or details on the pro environmental behaviors for monitoring cats or advocating for cats to be contained?
Yeah, so cats was one of the biggest concerns of our citizen scientists. So in Laura's interviews, they would often come up, you know, love conserving wildlife, I love monitoring them, but I'm so worried about the cats and, you know, dogs that are in here that might hurt them. So our camera trapping data would be collecting cat records particularly. But we haven't yet looked at that data because it's so many thousands of images. I was only able to look at what I could present today. Sorry, what was the second part of your question? Yeah. It was interesting because actually I felt like most people we spoke to were already really pushing for cat containment. Like, a lot of people felt like, you know, you have to keep your dog in your yard. People feel the same about cats. They really don't like seeing other people's cats within their yard. And almost all of our residents actually probably either had cat runs or had cats inside if they did have a cat. So I'm not sure if they necessarily changed their behaviour, but they were certainly more vocal about it to their neighbours and the community because they were becoming more and more aware of all the wildlife that was in their garden, and so it became like an even stronger issue to them. So I haven't been able to measure that effect, or we haven't been able to measure that effect, but like Costa said, the ripple effect, we don't know where it's going from there.
Do two more.
Thanks. Hey, I just wondered what platform you use to collect your data, like how, with all that data coming in, mm-hmm. do you use an app, or are you going through it all personally? How are you actually doing that?
Yeah. So it was something that we spoke a lot about in the first year. We were a bit wary of creating another app because there's so many around there. And also we just sort of opted in to sort of plug other apps that were already there and use them as resources, get engaged in those projects. So what we ended up doing was building a online data portal ourselves. So through a UWA Qualtrics, we had a preferred platform already. So we built sort of essentially a questionnaire, which we streamlined so that every week residents could go in, tick everything they'd done, tell us what they saw, the numbers. And yeah, we had that feeding back into a central location. Yeah.
Could you tell me if you've your resources and your ID guides are available online at all?
Yes. So at our website, wow, that's a bit of an oversight. I didn't pop it on the last slide. At that website, the training videos, the species ID guides, the field sheets, everything, all the resources are freely available at the website. And because the idea was to not only upskill and provide resources to the citizen scientists involved in the project, but also anybody that wanted to get involved, even if they just wanted to do it personally within their garden and learn about species. Yeah, so really accessible.
Well, Bronte. Thank you. Thanks for a great presentation.